Missouri, which is just a little bit east of Canada, or west of Kansas City, where I have relatives. Those are the only places I've ever been, other than here, and only for a week at a time. So basically, this is where I'm from, this is where I live, this is all I knew. And in October of 1966, I got a letter in the mail saying, friends and neighbors of your community. And right then and there, I knew it was a lie, because my friends and neighbors wouldn't do that to me. But anyway, I got drafted and went to the Army. In, of course, Vietnam, Southeast Asia was going. Now, I wasn't the brightest bulb in the room either. And so, but I had no idea what I wanted to do. All I knew was I wanted to, you know, start jotting the world and make a living. So, graduating high school, trying to get a job. My draft status was 1A. That means I was at the top of the list. It's very hard to get a job because people don't want you because you're not going to be there. Okay? So I was holding down two part-time jobs trying to get a full-time job. Finally landed one after about 2 or 3 months of pestering and calling every day. And then I was fortunate I got on at Hallmark Cards. And I worked there for not quite a year. The only downside of that was they needed a lot of machine operators. Well, machine operating paid a whole lot more than pulling stock. But I couldn't get one because of my draft status. Okay, so got on there and spent almost a year there, and then I got drafted. Went to Kansas City, the induction center. Everybody knows where the visitor center is over at the old train station in North Lawrence? Yeah, well, that was a working train station when I left. Took the train from there, went to Kansas City. Got put in the Army. Little side on that was, we had so many of us who were getting drafted at that time, they lined us up in a room. And they came down and tapped every third person on the shoulder. And they said, all those people we tapped, let's take one step forward. And they did. And they said, follow this man, you are now a United States Marine. So I was this close to being a Marine. So it took, went to the induction service up there and went down to Fort Leonard Wood, spent 2 months in basic training. From there, I went to a place called Fort Polk, Louisiana for my advanced individual training.
Let's do a college class. You want to go? I've come to speak with you today about the past and perhaps the future, to talk to you of war and of peace. For once I was sitting in a college classroom pondering life's unanswerable questions. Armed with youthful confidence and strength, my belief was based on innocence. My trust on inexperience and truth was an intangible to seek out. My generation has come and now is emotionally gone. Once a child of the 60s, I stand here now a man of the millennium. I was part of America's war in Vietnam. I went off as an eager, curious young man. I came back so weary, old, and tired. I saw reality, and it was bitter. I experienced truth, and it hurt deeply. All of my fairy tales, myths, fantasies, all my hopes and expectations exploded that year, and I have never, ever been quite the same. Today, the war in Vietnam has been condensed into a few mundane, sterile chapters lost in history and poli sci books. Some authors and even presidents have attempted to rewrite war's history, turning Vietnam into a righteous cause. History painfully, tragically reminds us all it was the children of America who fought and died alone in Vietnam. It was a 19-year-old teenager whose coughing blood spewed into the greasy red mud, who would never, ever become another day older, ever. For he was a draftee, the acceptable casualty, the expendable youth, the body count, and it was he this country could afford to lose. There's another story of Vietnam you can read and experience yourself in your quest for truth and reality. You'll see it in VA hospitals. You will feel it in military cemeteries. You can read it on Washington's Black Wall. For in those places you find the somber realities of war. As the survivors of that terrible war returned home, changed forever into human beings. For in war, men lose their souls. For what they do against that fellow man has no definition, no rhyme. is without reason, or the death of friends and comrades ultimately has no meaning, no context it can be put into, no manner it can be rationalized, no reason to explain or justify the painful experience. And these survivors came home searching for answers as to why they fought, searching everywhere for what they had lost, searching for what they could not find. But this loss, emptiness, this frustration, this searching finds no answers, no solutions, no true reason, no justification, no meaning. And today it still does not make sense, still defies rationale. Today you, America's new generation, sit in these same college classrooms asking your own unanswerable questions, probing for secrets of knowledge, of learning, the reason you're attending this institution. Yet another White House, another Congress, disregarding the cruel, hard, brutal lessons of losing war in the Vietnam experience, with no appreciation of the human sacrifice, the loss, the death, devastating toll, will gladly and willingly send your generation off to die in their war, a war no one can explain. But once again, it will be you, America's new generation, who will die in these wars of choice. You will be the price, the end result of America's endless unwinnable wars, fought in desert wildernesses, in ancient lands, which date back to before biblical times, to the Stone Age, talking about Afghanistan. Now, a small country which has never been conquered, yet America insists on fighting over there for nothing. What the hell are we thinking? I am today a Vietnam combat veteran who's killed for his country, who's seen his countrymen killed, who has been with them when they glazed over, who without another word, without another sound left this earth, leaving their broken, shattered body lying alone in the red mud slime. Today I'm a survivor of America's war in Vietnam. I have personal experience in learning wars about a deceitful government run by big corporations, about the greed and selfishness of self-indulgent politicians, the fickle shallowness of Congress or congressional representatives who are all talk, all bullshit, all noise, but no action. They are self-centered, pontificating lobbyist whores, pretending to represent constituents back home by sending America's new generation off to die in their deliberate, premeditated civil wars of choice.
Very good. Good soldiers, good discipline, good fighters. They were good. Okay? Not ragtag. They were good. So I got signed to the first cab, got there being a new guy in the unit. They have what they call LRPs, which are long range reconnaissance patrols. Where they take a group of 6-8 guys and they take you out and they clear out an area of 5 square miles and they put you in. You patrol that area and see what's there. And hopefully whatever it is, it doesn't find you, it's not bigger than you are. So being a new guy, that's what I got to do. I did that for 4 or 5 weeks. Got to learn a lot of stuff, by the way. One of my funny stories on that. We're out, like I said, you're in a small group, so you move every day, you're patrolling around. You patrol around and you figure out where you want to spend that night. You don't stop there. You go on past it. Then you stop, and when it gets dusk or almost dark, you move back, set up your perimeter. You set up trip flares, booby traps, everything around your perimeter, and you have 2 guys on and everybody else rests at the night. You switch off and on every 2 hours. One person that's on is your lookout, the other person has the radio. And you have the radio turned down as quiet as it will be. And you're listening there. And every hour they will call you for what's called a sit rep, situation report. And that's how you do it all night long until you get up the next morning, get everything together, and patrol some more. Well, you get in a habit of putting things in a certain place every time you lay down. And we didn't use tents or nothing, we just stepped out. So when you lay down, you always had your feet facing north. Or whatever worked for you, I always had my feet facing north so that I knew If something happened, I straightened up, that's north, that's south, east, and west. Our fallback position is south, so I know that's where I'm headed. Okay? You also put everything in a certain place. My best friend over there was a man named Marvin Dawkins, African-American from inner city Washington, D.C. How we got together, I'll never know. We went over as replacements together, got out there in the same place together, both new guys that put us together. We just re-blocked that the whole year long. Best man I ever knew. He had a habit of taking his helmet, and he put all his grenades in his helmet at night. Well, one particular patrol, booby trap went off, trip flare went off. First thing Marvin did was grab his helmet and throw it on his head. Then he started hollering, Marvin, oh man, Marvin, you'll get you. I'm trying to check out, find out what was the matter with him. And I looked in his helmet, seeing all his grenades. He kind of knocked himself out. No funny thing that happened. Okay, I spent some time there, then I went back, and that's where we stuck. Well, the Marines were trying to get into the Citadel in the inner part of the city. And what my conclusion is they would try to go in, well then, the North Vietnamese and Viet Cong would try to come out. The only trouble was, that's where we were at. We got our rear kicked every day for about a week because the Marines would go in and they'd come out. It's like a ping pong ball going back and forth between us. They finished up that. Anybody hear about, what was the name of it? Marine base up north that got surrounded and cut off.
But why are we fighting a civil war in Iraq? Afghanistan? Ask that to your congressman, Roberts. I've tried to talk to him. He's an idiot. Hey, he is. He won't talk to you. I'm a constituent, damn it, you're supposed to talk to me, huh?
I'm sorry, I gotta catch a bus.
Anyhow, I digress. I want to leave an imprint on you people. Why you're at college? Why it's important to hear people like me and him, and a teacher like Ray trying to open your minds, trying to get you to think, trying to get you to weigh the evidence and make your own decision. Which side is the handle on? Quick.
Front side.
The right.
The right side.
Oh, yeah. And if you're me, I don't see no handle, no stinking handle. Who's right? Who's wrong? Who's? Are you right? Yeah, you see the right, you see the center, you see the left. I don't see you. What the hell is this about? This is called an issue. This is called knowledge. And here, unfortunately, in Kansas, is what the Duck Dynasty considers knowledge. It's a little sharded fragment of right wing, Fox News, kill, Obama sucks, I don't know. But see, this is where a lot of people hang their life on. One little small piece of the big picture. Why you're in this class is to be able one day to look at things in all different directions and understand nobody's right or wrong, but you see it from a different perspective. It's that simple. It's not hard. But yet, how many of people you want to die for this when all of this is waiting? And that's why you're in class today. Because all of you are here today to try to see what the entire picture might be and how important it is to understand. So every time you pick up a cup of coffee, you're going to be haunted by this moment.
Got to Vietnam, they take all that because it's stateside gear. They store it and they issue you jungle gear. So when I came back, you know, I'm coming back and I've only got 6 months left. I'm probably going to get out early. So I said, you know, I carried all this stuff over here, stayed here, I'm not carrying it back. Okay, I had developed an attitude, okay? I'm not afraid to admit it, I had an attitude. So I went in and did all my paperwork and get ready to process back over, and the quartermaster gives me this whole bag of stuff. I looked at that bag, it's almost as big as me. I'm not carrying that crap. You know, you can have it if you want. Sell it on the black market, I don't care. I'll take it. He told me, no, you gotta take it. So we argued about it for a while, and I finally said, fine, so I took it. I picked up the bag, walked over to the nearest trash can, opened it up, and dumped it in there. And then I threw the bag in after it, and I picked up my little AWOL bag, which is a little short, like a gym bag, and I left and came home. Well, when I got back to Seattle, they gave me all new gear again, whether you had it or not. So anyway, so but they put you in the uniform. A lot of guys would go out and buy civvies, civilian clothes, to ride home in. They didn't want to be seen in their uniform because of the reactions you could get. A little bit different now. Back then, it wasn't a good thing. Here in town, you know, it didn't bother me that much. I did what I thought was right, and if that's your opinion, that's fine. I've got no problem with that. Just don't be ragging on me because of what I did. My mom had a little more trouble with that. She would go to the grocery store or any store here in town to do shopping or anything, and people would be making remarks about the soldiers in Vietnam, how they should all, you know, be killed and da 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 da. You know, my mom was a firebrand, and she did not like that. She could have gotten in trouble, too. Says, we're not going to put you out there until we lose control. And I'm going, oh, great. Well, here I spent a year in Vietnam getting shot at, and I'm coming back over here, I'm going to get shot at again. Fortunately, it never got to that point. We spent there until the convention was over, got on a plane back to Colorado, and showed them what happened. So, that's pretty much my time.
Dirt floors.
That was the way they lived. The people, well, I came in contact with that in the mountain yards. Did anybody ever have a mountain yard? There were a whole different race of people. They lived up the mountains. And they fought with crossbows. And they did not get along with the Vietnamese at all. I mean, that's oil and water. Okay, so you had another civil war, basically. Two different races did not mix.
I mean, the Korean Marines, I don't know if you've heard about, they're kind of badass. I spent 6 months with them. And in Korea, here's the background on the Korean Marines, the Turks were part of the NATO forces, and they took on the Korean ROKs and trained them how to fight a war. If you ever studied any history about the way Turks do things, they're not nice people. And if you piss them off, they'll kill you. If they think you're going to piss them off, they'll kill you. And if they're bored, they'll kill you. The Korean Marines, we were kind of left alone in the camp because they knew if they pissed off the Koreans, they'd come in and wipe out an entire village. And they did it many times. That's the way they fought the war. Now, PF, Popular Forces, which were the Vietnamese, they kind of fought the Viet Cong as if they owed each other money. Don't want to piss you off. It's like us in Russia. Okay. I don't want to. But where I was in the field, I was probably better protected than a lot because I was an American. We had the ratings. But we still got to. We're involved in walking out in the middle of a night and knowing people are watching us on the stand. It's not fun.
What they're fighting for. And Kurt may appreciate this. I looked at the lady and said, I'm over here fighting to get home as big a piece as possible. And she kind of looked at me and said, excuse me, I got job to do. Okay. That was the mentality of most infantrymen. And we wanted to get home in as big a piece as possible. Another thing is you often wonder why you're still alive. Okay? The guy next to you, you're laying next to a person. They're there 1 minute and they aren't the next. Why them and not you? That bugs you. You know, you try not to dwell on that, but it's there. Why am I special? Why am I still?
Is committing atrocities against other people, like what's happening in Syria or what's happening in the Ukraine?
Do you know any Syrians?
Do I? Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah.
Okay. You willing to die for them?
That's what I don't know. Because I'm just thinking, as a country, you have, I mean, if it's, we're not directly a part of it, that's one thing. However, you have, like, taking more of a step back and looking at your duty to humanity, I guess, in general.
And that's why we have the United Nations. Here's where I understand exactly. Are we the keepers of the world? Mm-hmm. Are we going to this Russian place? And my problem with all of that, it's never going to end. It's
sea rations all the time. Anybody know what sea rations are? It's food in a can. It's been in a can for a long time.
Years.
They have different things. Ham and eggs, spaghetti. One of them is ham and lima beans.
Beans and mushrooms.
Yeah, beans and fries. Ham and lima beans. Anybody like ham and lima beans? Not very many people. I like them. Now, the only reason I didn't want to carry them is because they were big and heavy. I don't want to carry heavy stuff. But to get to your about people, when we would go through villages and stuff, we would hand out sea rations. Well, most of the time, the stuff we didn't like. And they knew that. Well, I mean, they knew what was in the sea rations. If you give them a can of ham and limes, they give it back to you because they didn't like it either. So, you know, they had been Americanized to that point. They knew what they wanted, you know, they would take it. And a month later, we had to go through and clear it out again because they knew. You know, we're going through and they would get up in the hills and stay up there, and as soon as we left, they'd go down. Yes?
Some of the videos that we were watching talked about soldiers who had gone back to kind of find some closure. Mm-hmm. Have either of you gone back? Do you care to go back?
I'd love
to.
Do
you have any kind of interaction with Vietnamese people now? And how is that?
I want to write a book about that. I would love to go back. I don't know if I'd go back to apologize, probably. But, you know, you'd be going back to a place that has never left you in your mind. And like I said, I think every veteran I've ever met after a Vietnam experience is not pro-war, feels a tinge of guilt for what he did, against people who have no choice in the matter. That's how I feel. But you have to get the distance from what you've done and then ask the questions and come to your own conclusions. But what's your take?
I really have no yearning to go back. Stupid, but it was a growing experience for me. I learned a lot about myself. I grew up a lot in that year. And I really have no need to go back over. I have a friend of mine who is out in Western Kansas who I have a picture of, but he had PTSD pretty bad, and he's been back two or three times, and it's helped him greatly. Fortunately for me, I knock on something, I haven't had any problems so far.